Glenn, you made it. It's 2021. Happy New Year. And you made it to service on time. Here at River Glen, we've been looking forward to 2021 with a fresh, bold start and all sort of fresh beginnings. Last year was so crazy that many of us were focused on just plowing through. Maybe you let some things slip, like your exercise routine, healthy eating habits, or maybe your valued relationships. Or maybe you keep thinking about how, even through all these things, we can make this year better. 2021 is here, and now is the time to get going. In our Atomic Habits Message Series, we'll discover the little bitty changes that you can make to have a huge impact in your life. And if you're newer here checking things out today, that's great. We're so glad you're here. We've got hosts online in the chat windows, so be sure to give them a shout out and let them know you're here. We're gonna be celebrating communion every weekend. Just grab something to eat and drink so you're ready later in the service. And if you have kids at home, please check out our online Kid Life resources after service. It's something you can do with your kids so that they can grow a strong faith in Jesus. This could be a great routine to start with them this year. Service is almost ready to start. So, are you ready for transformation? Let's do this.
Good morning and welcome. We're so glad that you're here. Why don't you stand as we sing together?
The battle, you see my victory. When all I see is the mountain, you see a mountain moved. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. Nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you.
Come on, this is how we fight.
So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees, with my head lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet, and I'll sing through the night. Oh, the battle belongs to you. And if you are for me, who can be against me? Yeah. For Jesus, there's nothing impossible.
So when I You go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. And almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power.
Thank you.
is a King of glory. There is a God who saves, one who is strong and mighty. Freedom is in his name. So open the gates of heaven, lift up a shout of praise. There is a lion roaring, Jesus the King of glory. There is a lion roaring, Jesus the King of glory.
Well, good morning, everybody. We're so glad to be worshiping here with you this morning. And we want to let you know that if you are new with us today, that you don't leave this place without saying hi to somebody. After the service is over, head on to the Welcome Center and say hey to somebody out there and just talk to them for a little while, and they'll answer any questions that you have. If you're with us online, make sure you say hi to one of the hosts that are there to guide you through the whole service in the chat. We'd love to meet you there as well. We're going to sing another song together. This one's called Raise a Hallelujah. And over everything that's happened over this last year, the unexpected complications and whatnot, we firmly believe that there is always a reason and a way to raise a hallelujah. There is always victory at the end, and we're going to raise a hallelujah here in this place today. I hope you'll join us.
I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah, and heaven comes to fight for me.
I'm gonna sing.
I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King. Thank you.
God. Hallelujah. You guys can go ahead and have a seat. One of the most powerful lines in that song says, "Death is defeated, the king is alive." And if you've never heard that before, this is good news for us. That at one point, we were in need of a savior. We were stuck with the debt of sin in our lives. And God looked down on us with mercy and grace, and he sent Jesus for us. And Jesus paid the most deep price that he possibly could have paid with his life. But we believe that when Jesus was buried, 3 days later, he rose again, and he defeated death. And our king was alive. And what that means for us is that there is now victory at the end of the road. We believe that our God is more powerful than even death itself. So what do we have to fear? And so we remember this every week by taking communion together. We're going to do that in these next few moments. If you haven't had a chance to grab communion on your way in, you can still do that if you're here in the building. And if you're online with us, you can grab some bread and juice, anything that's nearby. And we welcome anybody who is a follower of Jesus to take this with us. We take the bread on the top, which represents Jesus' body that was broken for us. And we take the juice on the bottom that represents the blood that was shed for us on the cross. And we set aside moments to remember this and that it can change our very being. So I'm going to say a prayer for us today, and then we'll set aside some moments and we'll take communion. Father, we thank you for your son, Jesus. May we never forget the power of this story, the power of this truth that you sent us a savior. And now, Father, we have freedom and victory through you, that we have hope for change and hope for restoration. Father, speak to us in these next few moments. We want to hear your voice, and we want to hear what you have for us. I pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, hey, welcome. My name is Garrett. I'm the high school and college pastor here at River Glen. I'm so glad that you chose to spend your weekend with us. I hope your new year is off to a good start. We're only a few days in, so not enough time to mess it up yet. I hope you're sticking with those resolutions. I want to invite you, though, to come on out to the Welcome Center after service. If it's your first time, come say hi to me. I would love to meet you. If you're a student, middle school, high school, college age, wherever you're at, come say hi. I would love to get to know you, answer any questions you have, and get you connected to all of the ministries that we have available to you. We want to get you connected in this new year, and I believe that the best next step for you is coming to our Welcome to River Glen luncheon. It's happening next Sunday after our 10:30 service. Like I said, this is the best next step. This is a great way for you to get connected, an awesome way for you to meet some of our team. We want to serve you lunch and just share who we are and what we're all about so you can get an inside look at the DNA of River Glen. So bring your friends, bring your family, and come join us at our Welcome to River Glen lunch next Sunday. I'm excited for the new year, 2021, and as we look back at 2020, it was a crazy year, right? We're all kind of taking a deep breath, but we were able to see God do some amazing things, even in the midst of the crazy year. And we believe that the same thing is true for 2021, that God's going to do even greater things. And we're coming into this year with excitement and some a sense of being expectant, just believing that God's going to do amazing things. And a lot of that is possible because of your generosity. We're able to do awesome things within the church for our community because of you guys giving and partnering with us and partnering with God and what he's doing in and through our church. And so I want to invite you and encourage you and challenge you really to come into 2021 the same. To come in giving generously and giving boldly and living in that way, saying, God, we want to partner with you as we join you in seeing what you will do in this new ways to give, as you can see on the screen behind me. And I just want to encourage you and challenge you with this for 2021. Let's come in saying, God, we're joining you. Let's see what you can do in this year. We are excited to be kicking off a brand new series today called Atomic Habits. I believe this is a great series to begin our new year, and I really think it's going to bless you guys. So check this out.
Welcome, everybody. Good morning. Great to see you here in Waukesha and online and Pewaukee, wherever your location might be. Maybe you're with us for the first time today. Maybe you're coming back from Christmas. So good to have you with us as we begin a brand new year together. Hey, question for you. How many of you are hoping for a better 2021 than 2020? Yeah, everybody. We all do. And I really believe that 2021 is going to be a better year, generally speaking. But you know what? If you want a better year individually, personally, it takes more than just hoping or wishing or praying for a better year. I mean, it's not enough to just, you know, hope or wish for a better marriage or better relationships or better health or a better relationship with God or whatever area you want to improve. You have to change some of your habits if you want to have a better year. Marnie and I had something really unusual happen right before Christmas. It was a weekend before Christmas. It was Friday night, and we're in the living room watching TV together. It's about 9 o'clock at night, and I felt like I saw something out of the corner of my eye moving on the floor. And, you know, I looked, and I got up, looked around, didn't see anything, and went back to watching TV. About 15 minutes later, we hear this really strange sound coming from the bedroom section of our house. I walk back, and all of a sudden, this is what I saw on the floor in the hallway of our house. Yeah, a chipmunk in the house. He darted into one of the bedrooms. I mean, I shut the door right away, and I'm like, you know, how did you get in here, and what am I going to do now? And so I Googled the problem, and I put together a plan, and I sent Marnie in there to catch it. That's what I did. Now, here's what I did. It's actually Marnie's idea. It's a great idea. I went in the room, went in the bedroom, opened the windows a little bit, put a board up to the window. We were just hoping maybe the chipmunk would just, you know, figure out the way out on his own. And so, you know, we went to bed and we tried to sleep. And in the morning, first thing I did, I went to Home Depot and I bought one of these live traps. And I put some peanut butter in there and stuck it in that bedroom. We waited all day long, but the trap never activated. Finally, we went in there. We went through the whole room, couldn't find the chipmunk, and we figured he must have just found his way out of the
window. But then it started dawning on us, you know what, this probably isn't the first time that this chipmunk has come into our house. We've heard noises before. We found walnut shells in our basement. And so we put the trap in the basement, and guess what I caught a few days later? The chipmunk. The chipmunk had a habit of coming into our warm basement. He couldn't resist coming back because he had a habit. Habits are powerful for animals, and habits are very, very powerful for human beings, too. I've been reading, I've been doing some studying on habits. Came across an excellent book called Atomic Habits by James Clear. That's where we got the name for this series. We're going to share some of the ideas from this book in this series. But I love the name. I love the title of this book, Atomic Habits. Do you know what the word atomic means? I mean, I think a lot of people, when they hear the word atomic, they think of an atomic bomb. And that's how we expect change in our lives. You know, like a big boom, big atomic bomb, and everything changes in our life. But here's what the word atomic actually means. It means extremely minute, microscopic, itty-bitty, tiny. And that's the way real change happens in our life. I mean, outside of the day that you invited Jesus into your life, that was kind of like a bomb that went off in your life and changed everything. It changed your eternity. Outside of that, do you know how almost all transformation happens in our life? It's one step, one little step at a time. It's tiny. It's minute. That's why we handed out these candies, these atomic fireballs, when you walked in today. These little pieces of candy. Be careful if you put this in your mouth, because these things are powerful. They pack a punch. And in the same way, small changes, small habits make a really big difference in our lives. In fact, think about an average day in your life for just a moment. You wake up in the morning, your alarm goes off. Do you hit the snooze or do you do something productive? It probably depends on what you're in the habit of doing. And then as you make your way to work or to school, do you grab a donut or a healthier option? You probably have a habit. On your way to work, maybe somebody cuts you off. Do you just yell and scream? Or do you let it go? It probably depends on what you're in the habit of doing. When you get to work, do you surf the web? Do you scroll through social media? Do you say you're working at home and you're not? Or do you try to get your hardest work done first? It probably depends on what you're in the habit of doing. When other people gossip, do you join in? Do you lose your temper when somebody disagrees with you? Probably depends on what you're in the habit of doing. Do you know if we could review video footage of our daily lives? Here's what we wouldn't see. Someone making careful, thought-out decisions. No, what you would see is someone who operates largely out of habit. Duke University did a study, and they found that 40% of our daily actions are not carefully thought-out decisions. They're simply our habits. Here's a definition. A habit is a behavior in your life that you've repeated enough to just do it automatically, without even thinking, like brushing your teeth. And these habits may seem tiny, but they are atomic, and they can make a huge difference in our lives. Sean Covey put it this way: our habits will either make or break us. We become what we repeatedly do. Our lives are really the sum of the habits that we put in place. Craig Rochelle says successful people, and I think what he means here is healthy people, impactful people, do consistently what others do occasionally. Some people occasionally eat right, some people occasionally exercise, some people occasionally surround themselves with the right kinds of people, some people occasionally come to church, some people occasionally read the scripture. But the most successful people do all those things, they just do them consistently. Now, you might wonder, that sounds good, but, you know, does the Bible say anything about this? I mean, you've quoted from Atomic Habits and other sources, but does the Bible talk about this? Well, yes, it does. I want to show you a few scriptures. Take a look here at Hebrews chapter 10. Let us not give up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing. Gathering together, meeting together like this, it's a habit. And, you're either in the habit or you're not. Maybe some of us got out of the habit in 2020. It was so easy to do, but we're delighted. We're so glad you're here. And now is really a great time to renew or start this habit. In the Old Testament, in Daniel chapter 6, it says, but when Daniel learned that the law had been signed, by the way, this is actually really bad news for Daniel when this law got signed, he went home and knelt as usual in his upstairs room with its windows open toward Jerusalem. He prayed three times a day, just as he had always done, giving thanks to God. Daniel had a habit. Three times a day, he'd go to the same place at the same time, and he would pray to God. Do you know that Jesus developed habits? Luke chapter 5, Jesus continued his habit of retiring to deserted places and praying. In chapter 4 of Luke, on the Sabbath day, Jesus went into the synagogue, as was his custom. It was his habit. And the Apostle Paul had the same habit. In Acts chapter 17, according to his usual habit, Paul went to the synagogue. And finally, in Romans chapter 7, Paul gets transparent and he says, "For I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want." I can relate to that verse. I mean, I do things I don't want to do. You ever feel that way? You know, I don't want to eat this way, but I do. I don't want to be moody and irritable and lose my temper, but I do. We've got the best intentions, but like a chipmunk returning to a warm basement, we go back to those old habits. I heard somebody say that when you give a message like this on habits, you give a sermon like this on habits, I mean, the people who are good with habits, I mean, they love it. You know, they love a sermon on habits. But people who aren't good at it, they feel like a failure because they know they're going to try and they're going to fail, and they know they're going to try and they're going to fail, and they're going to think, "I've been down this road before." But I want you to know something. I have been that person. I mean, I've had so many times in my life when I tried to eat healthy, I tried to exercise, I tried to read the Bible each day and pray. And every example I'm going to share with you today, I mean, I have failed at it more often than not. But each of those failures moved me closer to establishing that habit. And I really believe today, if you don't just listen to this message and the messages in this series, but you apply them, I mean, it is going to move you closer to starting a healthy habit. You might not always hit it, on the bullseye, but it's going to move you closer to starting healthy habits. And this is a great time of the year to set goals and start new habits. Many of us have set New Year's resolutions in the past. Maybe some of us have set a New Year's resolution for this year. But did you know this? Studies show that 92% of New Year's resolutions don't make it to Valentine's Day. They're quit. They're forgotten. They're done. 92%. And so I want to address a question today. Why is it that many of us don't see the change that we want, even though we're committed to it? Why don't we see the changes that we want? Well, I want to go ahead. I want to share with you three reasons today. And here's the first one. We focus on the goal, but we don't understand the process. You know, if you think about it, I mean, all of us have pretty much the same goals. I don't know anybody that sets a negative goal. I don't know anybody who says, you know, my goal for 2021, I want to raise my cholesterol level to dangerous levels. Or, you know, I want to double the amount of financial debt that I have in my life. Nobody would say that, but many of us would say, I want to get healthier in 2021. I want to lose weight in 2021. I want to be financially free in 2021. I want to pay down my debt. I want to give generously. I want to read through the Bible in 2021. I want to spend more time with family in 2021. All of us have similar goals, but very different results. Why is that? Well, it's because we've got this tendency to focus on the goal instead of developing plans and systems for reaching those goals. Here's a quote from the author of Atomic Habits. Goals don't determine success. Systems determine success. Look at this. You don't rise to the level of your goals. You fall to the level of your systems. In other words, I mean, you can set some goals. You can set New Year's resolutions. You can write them down. I mean, you can have great goals. But if you don't establish a plan or a system to help you reach those goals, it probably won't stick. And you fall back into old habits. You don't rise to the level of your goals. You fall to the level of your systems. Now some of you might think, well, you know, that sounds good, but it doesn't sound very spiritual. But actually, if you look in the scriptures, you find many examples of people who set up godly systems that helped them to reach their goals. I want to go back to Daniel for just a moment. Notice again, it says Daniel had this habit of praying three times a day. It says he knelt down in a room upstairs with the window open facing toward Jerusalem. In other words, he didn't just say, you know what, I want to pray more. I want to get closer to God. No, he picked a specific time and a specific place to pray. Scholars believe that these three times a day were connected to meals. In other words, meals became a trigger, a cue for Daniel to pray. And so for us today, it'd be like I'm drinking coffee in the morning, and I'm going to open up my Bible and spend some time with God. For lunch today, I'm going to go for a walk. I'm going to get some exercise, and I'm going to do it with God. I'm going to spend some time with God. I'm going to put a little devotion book on the stand beside my bed, and each night I'm going to read a devotion before I go to sleep. That's how you form habits. One recent study found that if you want to exercise in the morning, you want to go run, you should put your running shoes and your workout clothes right next to the bed. And that way when you wake up in the morning, I mean, they're right there for you to put them on. And then you can reward yourself afterward. Maybe you have a cup of coffee and you're on your way to establishing a healthy habit. This is so important that we're going to spend some time next weekend talking about this and how all of us can set up practical systems in our lives that'll begin to change our outcomes. Here's another reason why many New Year's resolutions don't stick and we don't see the change that we want. We give up too quickly because we don't see change fast enough. You know, many of us could probably tell a story about this. I could tell lots of stories. You know, maybe you try a new diet, you know, to lose weight, and, you know, you go on this diet, and you're on the third day, and you step on the scale, and it says you've gained a pound, and you're like, this isn't working, I quit. Or you start reading your Bible, you read your Bible every day, and you're 2 weeks into it, and you lose your temper, and you think, this doesn't work. We quit because we expect instant results. I want to show you visually on a graph how experts tell us change actually happens and why many of us quit. Now, if this line right here represents the results that we want and this represents the amount of time, this represents how we think change will occur. I mean, it's just going to be up and to the right immediately, just this immediate spike up and to the right. But here's how change actually happens. I mean, we don't really experience any change at first. And then eventually, there's this big increase. You know what James Clear says about this area right here, this period of waiting, this period where we don't see any changes? He calls that the valley of disappointment because we don't see any immediate results. We think, this doesn't work. And that's why 92% of New Year's resolutions are gone by Valentine's Day because success lags. If you change your eating habits, it's not going to show up next week on a cholesterol test. If you start going to the gym and working out, you're not going to see any new muscle definition for maybe 2 or 3 months. If you stop drinking coffee and you take that money and you pay down your school loans with it, after a month, you're going to look at your school loan. It goes from $35,000 to $34,900. And you're like, that didn't even make a dent. And many times we quit, but we've got to endure. We've got to push through the valley of disappointment. You have to be patient before you see the changes in your life. Again, James Clear in his book, Atomic Habits, he says, the cost of your good habits are in the present. The cost of your bad habits are in the future. That's so true, isn't it? I mean, bad habits feel good in the moment. If I eat a hot fudge sundae, I mean, every single day, I mean, it feels good right now. I don't need it. I don't need any patience, but it's going to cost me in the future. Good habits do the opposite. Good habits cost you right now on the front end. Nobody wants to, you know, have a salad instead of cake for lunch. Nobody wants to, you know, get up early and go to work. Nobody wants to go to the gym. They cost you now, but they reward you in the future. And that's why the scriptures encourage us to be patient and not expect instant rewards or results. Galatians 6:9 says, let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we, say this with me, do not give up. So don't grow weary living on a budget. counting calories, going to the gym, going to church, reading scripture, at the proper time, God's going to do something amazing in your life if you simply stick with it. You know, maybe some of you have started coming to church at the beginning of this year. Maybe you've been away for a while and you're thinking, hey, you know, maybe by coming back to church, it's going to change my life. That's great. That's wonderful. But don't get discouraged after 1 week or 2 or 3 weeks. Stick with it every week, every weekend, and watch God do some amazing things, transforming your life. So why don't we experience the change that we want? One reason is because we focus on goals rather than plans and systems. Another reason is because we give up too quickly because we expect instant results. And then here's a third reason, and this is the most important one out of the three. We start with do instead of who. We start with do instead of who. Some of you are like, what does that mean? Well, I want to show you another diagram that represents three levels of change, and they're represented by three different circles. The first type of change is basically, what am I going to do? And these are the results, okay, that you want. Think about your resolutions. You know, I'm going to lose weight. I'm going to exercise. I want to lose 30 pounds. I want to get out of debt. I'm going to read through the New Testament. This is what I want to do. And then the second level of change is how. This is how I'm going to accomplish what I want to do. These are the systems and the plans and the habits that I put in place. I want to lose weight, so I need to go to the gym 3 times a week. I'm going to go Monday, Wednesday, Friday at 6 a.m. I want to read through the New Testament, and so I'm going to need a Bible reading plan, and I will create a habit of reading in the morning. And then the third level of change is the deepest and strongest level of change in your life, and it's who. This is your identity. This is who you are and who you want to become. This is your beliefs and values that will lead you to the deepest level of change in your life. Where do most people start? Most people start here and not here. But I'm telling you, starting here at who you are, who you want to become, this is a game changer because this is the strongest and deepest motivation to drive your behavior. Let me give you a couple of examples. This first example I came across about two people that want to quit smoking. That's a great goal. But I want you to imagine that one person starts here and the second person starts here. So this person here wants to stop smoking. Somebody comes up to this person and says, here's a cigarette. Have a cigarette. And this first person says, oh no, I'm trying to quit. And what has that person just done? That person has identified as a smoker, trying to quit. Now, the second person starts here. Somebody comes up to this person and says, here, have a cigarette. And this person says, oh, I'm sorry, I don't smoke. It's subtle, but don't miss it. I've changed my identity, and it is going to lead me to do what I want to do. Here's another example. This one's a personal example from my own life. Many years ago, I set this resolution, a New Year's resolution, to exercise every day. Every day. And so I got up January 1st, early in the morning. It was dark. I remember it was like 5 degrees outside. And I went for a run. And as many years ago, I can still remember that run. I hated every second of it. And I quit. I think I did it twice. And I quit. And I went many years without developing a habit of exercise. But then I found something that really helped me. Somebody encouraged me to do this, and that is to connect the habit of exercise to who I am and who I want to become as a faithful follower of Jesus. That is a game changer because our identity drives us to accomplish our goals. And if you've tried setting goals in the past and you're sitting here today thinking, oh, I've tried New Year's resolutions before, those don't work. Maybe it's because you started in the wrong place. Maybe you started here instead of here. You started with do instead of who. And there are so many scriptures that talk about this, about our new identity in Jesus. that inspires us and motivates us. For example, Paul says, "For we know that our old sinful selves were crucified with Christ so that sin might lose its power in our lives." We're no longer slaves to sin. No, for when we died with Christ, we were set free from the power of sin. Paul says, because of your new identity in Jesus, you've got the power to break old habits and to start new, healthy habits. We looked at this verse earlier where Paul talked about his struggles. He said, I do what I don't want to do. But then a few verses later, look what he says. Who will free me from this life that is dominated by sin and death? Thank God, the answer is in Jesus Christ, our Lord. It's through Jesus, because he makes you a new person with a new identity and a new power and a new future. So I got a few takeaways, a few challenges for all of us today. And here's the first one. Before you write down goals or resolutions for 2021, I want you to write down this week who you want to become. I want you to write down some identity statements, some identity goals. Here's what I want you to do this week. I want you to just take out a piece of paper, blank sheet of paper, and on the top half of one side of one sheet of paper, I want you to write some identity statements. Who do you want to become? And it doesn't have to be long. You don't have to write pages and paragraphs. Just a few identity statements on the top half of one sheet of paper. I did this myself this week. You know, who do I want to become? And you know what helped me do this? It helped me to visualize my funeral. I know that might sound morbid to you, but I visualized my funeral, and it was in this room, and my wife Marnie was right over here on the front row crying profusely, and she's like, "I just can't take it. I will never marry again. He was so good looking," and I'm kidding, but it helped me to visualize my funeral, and what do I want people to get up and say about me? How do I want people to describe my life? Now, if that's too morbid for you, do this instead. Just imagine you walk up to a group of people. It's some of your family. It's some of your closest friends. They don't know you're there. You're eavesdropping. What do you want them to say about you, about who you are? You know, write down, who do you want to become? And so I began writing down some statements, and I'm going to just share some of them with you, okay? Here's what I wrote down. Here's just a few of them. I want to put Jesus first in my life. I want to be a man of character who does what is right, regardless of the cost. I want to love and treasure and cherish and encourage my wife, Marnie. I want to love and encourage and set an example for my kids and my granddaughter. I want to help more people find Jesus and follow Jesus. Those are just a few for me. Who do you want to become? Write it down. Write it down. It doesn't have to be super complicated or super long. Write it down on the top half of one side of one sheet of paper. You could do this with your family. You could do this with your kids together. Here's number two. On the bottom half of that same page, write down some small habits that reinforce who you want to become. Now, we're going to help you with this in the next couple of weeks. Don't miss a week of this series, but you need to start now with writing down and starting some small habits that reinforce who you want to become in 2021. Don't underestimate the power of small habits. Remember, they're atomic, but it's important to connect those habits with who you want to become. And then third, don't get discouraged if you slip up or you don't see immediate results. Remember, you're not gonna do this perfectly. You're not gonna see this big spike, you know, with big results immediately. But if you would simply stick with it, you will reap a harvest of change in your life like you have never seen before. So write down, who do you want to be on the top of the page? That can stay the same each year. But then on the bottom half, determine what you want to do this year. Write down some small habits. Connect those with who you want to become. And God's going to use those small habits. They're going to be atomic. God's going to use them to transform your life. I'm going to pray that God will compel you to do that this week. Let me pray for us. Father, thank you that in your word, you make it clear to us how habits are important and powerful in our lives, and how it starts with who before do. I pray that all of us today would not walk away without deciding to do this one thing this year that may be different than we've ever done before, writing down who we want to be before we ever start writing what we want to do. And God, would you take our identity that we write down and would you help it drive us to the right behaviors? Give us a vision for our life and motivation and inspire us like never before to become who you want us to become. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's stand together for our last song.
There's a place for me. I'm a child.
thank you for being here with us this morning at River Glen. If you're new, make sure you head out to the Welcome Center before you leave. We will see you next time.
Thanks for spending time together with us. I hope that you're encouraged and able to apply today's teaching into your life immediately, and that you can't wait to join us for service next weekend, either online or in person at our Waukesha or Pewaukee campuses. If you haven't already done so, click the connect button and fill out a welcome card. Be sure to let us know how we can be praying for you and how we can help you take your next steps in faith. Finally, when you fill out the welcome card, every Thursday you'll receive my What's Happening RG e-newsletter filled with encouragement and updates about River Glen for you and your family. I invite you to be on mission with River Glen, to celebrate each week at service, to contribute to our community and world, and to connect with others in faith. This is just one way that together we can make more and better followers of Jesus. Stay safe and stay on mission. See you soon.